Last afternoon of talks, and we're going to start with Fernando Kuckerman from the Universidad de Buenos Aires, and he's going to talk on the stability of polynomial logarithmic differential one forms.
Okay, thank you. ¿Se escucha? ¿Sí? ¿Se escucha? ¿Sí? Okay, it's a pleasure to be in...
Is it not working?
But the microphone is working. Okay, okay, all right. So it's a pleasure to be in Rio and IMPA and to be in ALGA. I thank the organizers of ALGA and also Jorge and the other organizers of the foliation seminar for the opportunity to speak here. I've been in several ALGAs before. Actually, I was trying to look when I was there, and I didn't find. I was there, sure, 2006 and a few other times. Before that, I don't remember, which I think I was in several occasions. And they were always very, very nice, friendly conference, small, and this one is bigger, I think, a little bit bigger, and always with a high quality and friendly atmosphere. So it's nice to see that these good things continue over time. So it's nice, this celebration, that to see that these things are maintained. So congratulations for that. Okay, so I will speak about the basic subject is the integrable differential forms of foliations, especially in a projective space. The stability that we are talking about is the fact that a collection that you make a perturbation of a differential form which is integrable, and you perturb it. You have a family of integrable forms, and you perturb one of them, and it belongs and keeps belonging to your family. So your family is stable. In other words, it constitutes an irreducible component of the algebraic variety of all Frobenius integrable forms. So the basic problem is to determine these irreducible components. Okay, I will be a little bit more precise in a second. So one of the known irreducible components by a theorem of Omegar Calvo is the collection of logarithmic forms. So what I will show you today is a new proof of Omegar Calvo's theorem, with a little bit improvement in the sense that we will see that this irreducible that the moduli space of foliations along the irreducible component of logarithmic forms is reduced. Okay, so that's a consequence of our proof, which will be infinitesimal methods, okay, determining the tangent space of the space of foliations at a logarithmic form. So this is the calculation I will show you that we can do, okay? So since that vector space will have the expected dimension, then an easy lemma, a general lemma, will implies that the collection of logarithmic forms constitutes an irreducible component, and this component is reduced. Okay. The way we the fact that this space is reduced, when I started working in foliations, especially when George started teaching me foliations, we thought about this problem, and we did many calculations to show that, because we had in mind these examples by Manford of a Hilbert scheme which is non-reduced, right? So we were wondering if the same happened in this moduli space. So we believed that maybe these were examples or not. We did many calculations at that time. The problem remained there. But I am now working with Cesar Mastri in developing the formation theory of foliations, or and more generally of exterior differential systems. So we were looking at that. So since they have singularities, so you have to know about special kinds of singularities. The special kind of singularity that comes up is the regular singularities in the sense of Camacho and Linz-Neto. So these are a condition that I won't discuss, but we were reviewing the paper by and trying to understand in deformation theoretical terms the paper and the definition of Camacho and Linz-Neto of regularity. So we were looking at that, and because that's used in many other theorems, that's a basic ingredient, and they have a calculation there, a long and very explicit calculation that the logarithmic forms they are regular in their sense, and that's a calculation which is very explicit, and we want to understand, you know, how they did it, and then we try to simplify it. And finally, we came up with what we thought that was a very easy way to prove algebraically the theorem of Omegar-Calvo and the reducedness. At some point, we thought that we had a very short proof, but then the proof that had a gap, and so we almost had a proof. We started to correct it. Was not our initial intention to do this, but you know, we were just doing it, so we tried to correct it. So the proof became a little bit more complicated, but still is different and gives the result of reducedness. So what I would like to do now is to show you the main steps for this proof that we finally did. Okay, so yeah, so. So this is, we have the problem that I described, the problem of irreducible components of spaces of foliations. What are logarithmic, so this is basically the plan. I will go quickly through the definition of logarithmic one forms. We have this new proof of stability and the fact that it is reduced. It's a joint work with Javier and Cesar. Javier is a student of mine that he's finishing the thesis working with logarithmic two forms. So he started working with logarithmic forms of any degree, but finally he's able to prove a theorem of stability for two forms. Okay. So, and he made very nice contributions also to the case of one forms. So he finally, the paper is the three of us. Well, the idea of the proof is, as I said before, to compute the tangent space to the moduli space of foliations at a point corresponding to a logarithmic form, okay? So we need to estimate the infinitesimal deformations of a logarithmic form and see what we have, okay? Well, let me just recall quickly some basic definitions. We will work in a projective algebraic variety over the complex numbers, which in a second will be the projective space. We have a line bundle. We will consider a twisted differential one form. So, and then the Frobenius integrability condition, the space FXL will denote the collection of all the forms that satisfy this condition. It's an algebraic variety given by quadratic equations, because this condition is quadratic in omega. So this is a inside of this big projective space, this is an algebraic variety defined by many quadratic equations, and the problem is to determine its geometry. Okay. Okay. So in case a projective space, our forms are written like that. I prefer to use this notation where the degree of the form, I will look at not at the degree of the foliation, but the degree of the form, which I call D. So that means that the polynomials have degree D minus 1. So the total degree of the form is D, because the D of xi have a degree 1, so the total degree is D. And this omega defines a section of omega 1 of twisted by D, if it descends to projective space, which means that the coefficients have to satisfy this condition, which means that the contraction with the radial vector field is zero, okay? So this is our space of foliations. Now we will introduce the logarithmic forms. This is a special type of integrable forms. They depend on some combinatorial data, so we will fix a partition of the number small of the number d. Okay, so for each such partition, we will consider logarithmic forms of type d. These are so what's written here is what's usually called a section of omega 1 log d. It's a logarithmic form with poles along these hypersurfaces. We may as well suppose that they are irreducible. And that's why in the title I talk about polynomial logarithmic forms, because we make it by multiplying by the product of all the denominators, we just make it polynomial, right? So when we do that, we kind of lose the location of the poles. Generically speaking, the location of the poles will be recoverable. It will be unique, but it may happen that you lose that information. So, but this is in this expression is what we call a logarithmic polynomial form. Okay. It may be written it may be written like this, or like this. This fi hat is the product of the fj's with j different from I. So this is an expression which makes it clear the form is polynomial, okay? Well, such forms is an easy exercise to see that, is homogeneous of this degree, is integrable, and the form descends to projective space if and only if the lambda i's, the residues, satisfy this linear condition. Okay? So now we will consider the collection of all these logarithmic forms. It's just the image of this map. This map that takes the collection of residues, the collection of poles, and constructs the logarithmic form. So this map is, this is a vector space, this is also a vector space, this map is multilinear, it is linear in the lambda i's, is well, multilinear in the fi's. So we are looking basically at a kind of Segre variety, it's a projection of a Segre variety, it's the image of a multilinear map, okay? So this is the space of logarithmic forms when we fix the multi-degree d, okay? So this is, we call like this, the collection of all logarithmic projective one forms of this type. This map may have a base locus because it could be that this such an expression it could be zero, okay? So here we are talking about the multilinear map. Before going to projective space to projectivize everything, we have to be a little bit careful. First of all, the image is not projectively closed. I mean, you have to. If you want to projectivize, which is convenient for some things, we have to remove the base locus, and then we have to take the Zariski closure of the image. Okay, so if we do these two things, what we have is what I call like this the projective logarithmic component. So this is what, when we talk about the logarithmic component, we mean this, okay? So this is the space of logarithmic forms. This is the one that we will end up showing that is a irreducible component of the space of foliations, which lives inside here, okay? The space of all forms. Okay, so here, let me just mention quickly that we are able to describe quite explicitly the base locus. The base locus has different components. They are parameterized by every time you are able to write down your D as E times D prime, you factorize it, where E is a matrix of natural numbers, and D prime is also a collection of natural numbers, all positive. For every such factorization, we have an irreducible component of the base locus. So we know exactly what the base locus looks like. It's a union of Segre Veronese varieties. I don't need it, but the base locus, we know it exactly. It's no problem, okay? And
if it's high over here, you would ask if you know the base key.
What?
If it's high over here, you would ask about the base key.
Yeah. I think if we wanted to compute the degree of the image, we would need that. And I think it's all prepared to do it. And I was wondering why Israel didn't come, because I wanted to show him this. But I think it's complicated. But I think in the first cases one could start doing that. Yeah, that would be interesting. I'm sure Israel will buy it immediately. So okay. So the next thing we will do, this map, which I called, I don't remember how I called the parametrization map, I call it mu, okay? This is the affine version, and the projectivize of mu is rho. I don't know why I choose all these names, but mu is for multilinear, rho, I don't know. I call it rho, okay? But another feature of this map is that we can check that it is generically injective. Generically injective up to order, because there is a lack of injectivity coming from the fact that if there are some repeated DIs, if some DIs are repeated, obviously you can permute them and you will have permutation of this and permutation of this will give you the same form because the sum is commutative. But except for that, the map is injective, okay? Generically injective. So the image, we know the dimension, it's just a dimension of the domain. So the next thing I would like to do is to calculate the derivative of this parametrization. Basically, the main step would be to compute the derivative and to show that the derivative map is surjective. That's the main problem, and once we do that, all follows. So the derivative means that we will make a perturbation in the domain. We will make a perturbation of lambda, which is the residue, and f, which is the poles. We will perturb them, and so a perturbation would be to add a lambda prime and add a collection of polynomials f prime, and we just send it and see what we get. This is the derivative, right? So when we calculate, just derivative of a multilinear map is something we teach in calculus. This is a case of that. But when you write it down, you get this. This expression looks kind of ugly. So we were looking at this expression a lot to see if we could. Basically, the problem will be that we will have a perturbation of a logarithmic form, and we will want to write it in such a way for some lambda i's and some f primes. That's what surjectivity of the derivative means. Okay. Okay. This here, this condition, is the tangent space of the space of foliations at the point omega is all the alphas that satisfy this equation. Okay? So we will take an alpha satisfying this condition, and we will and the objective will be to write it like this. Okay? So that's what we want to do, and we will do. Okay? So then the theorem is that the inclusion of, you know, the image of the derivative into the tangent space of the space of foliations at omega, that this inclusion is an equality, not always, but for a sufficiently general point in the domain. Okay, that's enough to conclude. Well, then we start playing around with try to organize a little bit better all this mess. To try to do this surjectivity of the derivative. A notation we use is eta will be just the logarithmic part, just omega divided by f, just the logarithmic section. Okay, section of omega 1 log d. We will have the chance to work with that sheaf. And the same we do with alpha. Alpha is so we will denote beta alpha divided by f, and it has some nicer features. When we divide by f, we can write some things in a nicer way. So one thing that happens. For a beta that comes from that already is the derivative of something, is that it can be written in this way. It can be written as eta prime, which is logarithmic, is the logarithmic part where the f's are fixed and the lambda i's are perturbed. So this is kind of the partial derivative in the direction of the lambdas, okay? Then beta can be written like this, the logarithmic part, and then something that is a multiple of eta, which is the original, is the point at which we are taking the derivative, and then an exact form. So it's, you know, like the standard thing that, you know, modulo exact, you get something that is logarithmic plus something that is just a multiple of the one we had. So this looks useful to start working with things like cohomology of the complement of a divisor, omega 1 log d, these calculations that they do in Hodge theory, stuff like that. So at some point we thought that with these instruments we could do a short proof, the short proof I mentioned at the beginning. But let me also recall the singularity scheme of omega. The scheme of zeros is simply the points where omega is zero. So it's basically the ideal generated by the coefficients. Okay. So this is the collection of singularities, the singular scheme of a form. Now, for a logarithmic form, the singular scheme has the following shape. We denote xi, the hypersurface of poles, fi equal to zero. Then we take the double intersection, the triple intersection, and so on. X to X sub A is the intersection of all the Xi's for I in A. A is a subset of the indices. And then we take the union of the X sub A's for a cardinality of A equal to a fixed number R. For example, X sub 1 is just the divisor of all poles. X sub 2 is you know, the union of the double intersections, the union of the triple intersections, and so on. These varieties will play a role in a second. What happens that is well known is that this codimension 2 stratum is part of the singular set of a logarithmic form. Basically, the singular set of a logarithmic form is this codimension 2 part, which is called the Kupka part, and then another smaller dimensional, usually a collection of isolated points. These are the singularities of a logarithmic form, okay? As I'm recalling here, the singularity scheme of a logarithmic form is a codimension 2 stratum union some points, some usually, generically is a finite set of points. Okay. So in the proof, it will play a role knowing the resolution of the ideal of which I am denoting J2 is the ideal of X2. X2 is a union of finitely many complete intersections of codimension 2. Okay, Fi equals Fj is a complete intersection of codimension 2, and we take a finite union of them. That's not a complete intersection anymore. So its ideal is, what's true is that this ideal is generated by the Fi's hat. If you think about it for a second, you will see that the Fi hat, it vanishes on X2, because on a component X2, Fi and Fj both vanish. So the Fi hat are zero, these polynomials are zero along X2, and they generate the ideal of X2. And this collection of polynomials, the Fi hat, they don't form a regular sequence. But the relations is like when you have a Kozul complex, where the relations are the trivial relations. Here, there is a slightly less trivial, but still, we can call them trivial relations, because Fj times Fj hat is F. Fj hat was F with Fj removed. When you put it back, you get F. So when you do it with J or with 1, is the same, and you get 0. Okay. So these are the trivial relations. And it's true in this case that these relations generate all the relations. Okay? So it's not very surprising, but it works. I looked in commutative algebra books and stuff like this, and I didn't see this result. I mean, I asked a few experts, and they gave me some references of things that do things that are extremely general, and this is, particular case that you have to, work a lot to see that this is a particular case. But this statement done directly, I didn't see it. So we can prove it easily. So this codimension, in this case, this codimension 2 variety is Cohen-Macaulay, because it has a resolution of length 2. So this map is the generators I just said. This map is the relations I just said. Notice that if I put J and I, these are relations also, but they are easily generated by one of the indices. We just pick it to be 1, and these are independent now. When you just take J and 1,
are you assuming that they are general?
FJ? Yes. We'll assume that the collection of the FJ is they are general. Yeah, it's how do you say?
Normal crossing.
Yeah, regular sequence, because the number of them could be there are two cases. The number m could be much higher than the space,
right.
or lower. Both cases are included, right? But it's normal crossing. So locally, they are like a regular sequence. So we assume that, which is enough, because we are trying to see that the map is generically surjection, you know, so we can assume that. Okay, now here comes a remark that for us was important, which is this. We observe this thing, which is the same formula I wrote before, is a typical element in the image of the derivative. It looks complicated, but well, we just collect this term with this term. We just write it like this. And now when it's written like this, you have here is multiples of fi hat and multiples of f. When we remove fi and fk. So all these guys, they vanish on x2. All this vanishes on x2 because of the previous proposition, right? Because they are multiples of the generators of the ideal of x2. And all these guys vanish on x3, on the stratum x3. In particular, they all vanish on x3. So this is a feature that has anything that is in the image of the derivative. All of them vanish on x3, on the stratum x3. Okay. From this remark, we will try to do it in the inverse and prove surjectivity like this. So our strategy to characterize the elements that belong to the tangent space will be this. First, we shall determine, we will pick any element, a known element in the tangent space, and we will restrict it to x3 and see what happens. Then when we will understand what happens with alpha restricted to x3, then once we do that, we will try to go from the codimension is called depth, right? We go from depth 3 to depth true, so like going from the bottom of the sea to the surface. When we go to the surface, we survived and we prove surjectivity. This is the idea, right? And so we will look at what happens in the stratum depth 3. Once we do that, we will determine alpha in x2. And once we do that, we'll be able to show that any alpha is in the image of this map. Well, okay, so this is the idea. Well, this is just an intermediate proposition, just the formulas for the d omega, and we can skip this. Okay, what happens is that we can prove that any alpha on x3 is zero, which is good news. If any alpha will be in the image of the derivative, anything in the image of the derivative we said was zero on x3. So we can prove that actually any alpha, which is a tangent vector, satisfies that, is zero on x3. So on x3 we know them, we know all the elements, all the tangent vectors, because they are zero on x3, okay? I don't have time to give the proof, which is not complicated, it's short. So now we will try to understand alpha on x2. Okay. Now we will try to understand alpha on x2. So x2 is a union of codimension two complete intersections. So to understand it on x2, we need to understand it on each of its irreducible components, so xij, where fi and fj are zero, okay? And this is the what happens. It's written like this. It's a multiple of the fij hat, because it vanishes on x3, so it has to be a multiple of this. And so it's a linear combination of these two guys. And then we can show that the coefficients, which are polynomials, are actually like this for some polynomials f prime hat. So at this stage, this is nice because we have our candidates. At this stage, we already determined what are the f primes that we need, right? They show up in x2. So the restriction of alpha to xij can be written like this. Well, that requires a proof, which I will skip. So once we have this, right, this happens on xi, we will just take the sum. We will have to take the sum of all these over I and j, and then alpha, our unknown alpha, when we compare with that sum, they will be the same on x2. So the difference will vanish on x2, right? So we do that, except that there is a little something that we have when we take the sum of these guys, it doesn't satisfy the it's not a tangent vector necessarily, and then we have to, but it's easy to correct. You just have to add something. This is no problem, and then the statement is that any alpha can be written as a sum of alpha 1 plus alpha 2, where alpha 1 belongs to the image, so this is our friends, and alpha 2 also is a tangent vector, but it vanishes on x2, okay? So now that means that to show the surjectivity, we will take an alpha, which is a tangent vector, but we will be able to assume that it vanishes on x2. Because of this proposition, it's enough to show that the tangent vectors which vanish on x2 are in the image. Okay? So from now on, I will be working with tangent vectors, perturbations of our omega that vanish on x2. Vanishing on x2 morally means that these are deformations that don't move the singular set, more or less. If it doesn't move the singular set, so these are equisingular, if you like, deformations, first order deformations. We would like to characterize them, right? But it's an accurate first guess, but we will see in a second that it's not completely right. I mean, we have to be a little bit careful with that, but that's a more or less good intuition, okay? So then the next proposition, and we are close to the end of the theorem because I'm skipping the proofs, is that, well, what I said before, that any first order deformation that vanishes on x2 belongs to the image of the derivative. Now, once we prove that, we finished, okay? The extra twist is that, is the following. We will say that this multi-degree is balanced when each di is smaller than the sum of all the djs, j different from I. So none of them is too large. No, every one of them is smaller than the sum of the others. Okay, that's balanced. So so to prove this proposition, actually, we have to divide it in two cases: the case where the multi-degree is balanced, and the general case where it's not necessarily balanced. In the case where it is balanced, the intuition I mentioned before works fine, and what happens is that we can show that any alpha like this that vanishes on x2 may be written like this. So it's written like for some numbers, lambda I prime is written like this. So it comes from, it's a partial derivative in the direction of the residues, so it's just a perturbation of the residues, okay? In particular, it's in the image of the derivative map, and then the derivative map is surjective in that case. Okay. What happens in the case in the non-balanced case is that we have to we can prove that alpha will be written like this plus an extra term which is a multiple of f F1 hat. That means it's a multiple. It's a, there are deformations that move the FIs without moving the condition that X2 is zero, because there exist forms that vanish on all the divisors except one, and that makes that there are other infinitesimal deformations which are not logarithmic, but still we can write them down and see that they also belong to the image. So everybody belongs to the image, and then the image is everything. And that, by a standard lemma, implies that the irreducible variety, which is the image, is an irreducible component, and that the space of foliation is reduced along this component. The surjectivity of the derivative map implies that. At what time did I start?
You have some 7 minutes.
No, I mean, let me just mention that Javier is doing an argument of this kind. We thought that something like this would work for forms of any degree. But it became too complicated, so he will be doing it. It's already complicated enough for Q equals to 2. So I guess we need a new idea to make it simple, but it's fairly complicated. But he's doing it for Q. So basically, a FAF system where omega 1, omega 2, where omega 1 or omega 2 are logarithmic, these kinds of foliations, okay? So this correspond to a logarithmic two form. Also, another thing that maybe we should mention is that this logarithmic two Q forms with Jorge and Israel, we did we had a work where we consider rational Q forms. So the logarithmic Q forms is a common generalization of the rational Q forms and the logarithmic one forms. So it's a common generalization. So it seems that will work, and it will be a component for arbitrary codimension. I think that will be, that's not done yet, but I think we'll be able to do it. That's it.